Okay, the goal today is to get through Kant's grounding to the metaphysic of morals, right? As the translator's introduction to this edition of the text, the Hackett one I had to buy for the course, points out, Kant's moral philosophy is profound and lengthy, and the place to start is undoubtedly right here with his grounding. And as it says here, heaven help the one who enters thereon. Right? Now, two reasons. One, Kant presupposes you've read his other texts. Right? So there's a lot of presupposed knowledge here. There's a way to introduce this that does not need a whole lot of that, and that's what I hope to offer you here. Kant is bad at determining when he needs his reader or needs to offer an example to illustrate for his readers. Right? So, for example, as your translator points out, Kant is going to formulate five different formulations. We're going to take a look at three of them of the categorical imperative, which he says are equivalent, five different ways of saying exactly the same thing, but he doesn't provide the reader with a lot of background to see exactly how these formulations are equivalent. I hope to enlighten you a little bit there. Your translator concludes his introduction by saying, "But students, be of good cheer. Your teachers, one hopes, will be able to lead you through the maze. If they falter, consult the ensuing selected bibliography for further help, and never forget that struggling with Kant or any other great but difficult philosopher can be very rewarding." Now, he's referenced the selected bibliography to this book, which is excellent. Right? I would recommend that if you're in need of extra help, you look at that selected bibliography, and there are lots of different commentaries there on this material that might be of large help to you with regard to this. Now, what I've done in addition to give you this is provide several other accounts of this material in addition to my own. The first is from Rick Roderick, who introduces John Stuart Mill, Jeremy Bentham, and Immanuel Kant sort of in tandem with one another, calling them models for moral systems rather than for moral choice making, rather than, right, complete self-sufficient moral systems themselves. Kant would dispute that, as would John Stuart Mill and Jeremy Bentham. So that's why these two sections are presented hand in hand with one another. There is a good argument for that, though. The other is Michael Sandel, who is a professor at Harvard. Right? Roderick was at Duke. Sandel at Harvard, and as part of his justice course, what Sandel does is explore Kant's notion of freedom, which we'll touch on today, and largely his Kant's treatment of the what I'm going to call the second formulation of the categorical imperative, the one that establishes human beings as ends in themselves and forbids us from using other human beings merely as a means to our own ends, right? Merely, right? That's an important word for Kant. We will get into that as well. So you'll have those additional resources in addition to this resource that I'm giving you now, in addition to the textbook and the translator's notes, which are quite good throughout this, in addition to Kant's actual writings, which it's oddly compared to his other writings, it's like Kant learned how to write at this point. All of a sudden, he is giving you examples, right? So, in the preface, right, and how this is going to go is I'm going to chug away, I'm going to utilize the notes behind me, and then I'm going to pause, I'm going to put new notes on the board, and we're going to move into the next section. So this video, you'll see two or three abrupt transitions where the notes behind me change. I'll try to ease you through those as comfortably as possible. Because there are, the preface, section one and parts of Section 2 that we'll be taking a look at in our journey through Kant's moral philosophy here. Now, what Kant is doing in the preface, and largely he's doing three things. One, he's telling you what he means by a metaphysic of morals, right? Secondly, he tells you in very clear terms what he's looking for in the way of the importance of this investigation, right? So he's got very strict sort of moral guidelines that he's trying to establish with this investigation, and he's going to lay those out for you as well, and then give you an idea of what he's looking for on page 5 of your preface, where he says that we're seeking out and establishing the supreme principle of morality, right? So really what Kant thinks he can do here with his metaphysic of morals is lay out what he calls the supreme principle of morality and put all moral doubt completely to rest, right? So that's what he is going to do. All right. Now, I also have a set of my own notes here, which makes sense to nobody but myself. Kant begins by pointing out that ancient Greek philosophy, which we've studied to some extent, it is divided into three specific sciences. I know when I was introducing them, I introduced them in terms of metaphysics, epistemology, and ethics, and they map fairly well onto the three Greek sciences that Kant is identifying here: physics, ethics, and logic. Right? Logic being akin to epistemology, epistemology in its purest form, I suppose. Physics, which when we understand it theoretically, we wind up understanding as metaphysics, right? And then ethics. Now, what Kant is trying to do is question these three categories, right? And to some extent blend them, but to some extent disambiguate them as well. I may have just created a word there, but nonetheless, make them less ambiguous, right? So he's trying to be very precise in terms of defining exactly what he's doing. He starts off by arguing that all rational knowledge is either material or formal. When knowledge is material, it's concerned with some object, right? So when I have rational knowledge that is material, it's always concerned with this or that or some particular object, right? When it's formal, right, it relates to no determinate object whatsoever, right? Now, in terms of material philosophy, right, there are two large branches, right? The laws of nature, that pertains to physics, right? The doctrine of nature kind of thing. When we are doing philosophy about nature, right, then we are concerned with what we've come to understand contemporarily today as physics, right? The laws thereof. Every action has an equal and opposite reaction, the laws of thermodynamics, etc., etc., right? When it is concerned with freedom, it's called ethics or a doctrine of morals, right? Now, formal, right, philosophy can only have one category, right, which is logic, right, which doesn't have any empirical part. I mean, we're concerned with making logical arguments, but largely these logical arguments fit a formal structure, and when you study logic, what you find is the propositions don't necessarily relate to any particular determinate object or any particular case. The cases are mere illustrations for relationships between ideas. It operates a lot like mathematics, which in its purest form is not multiplying apples by apples or oranges by oranges, but rather it's number, which is a pure abstract entity, right? So logic is the only category in terms of formal, right? Now, Empirical philosophy is based on experience. Pure philosophy, on the other hand, sets forth its doctrines as founded entirely on what Kant calls a priori principles. A priori principles are literally principles from before. They're abstract principles that are found out by reason. Right? So pure philosophy, when it is merely formal, is called logic. Right? Pure philosophy, when limited to determinate objects of the understanding, is called metaphysics. Right? And in that category, we find theoretical physics and what Kant calls a metaphysics of morals. Right? So there, these two kinds of metaphysics, one's pertaining to nature, right? Theoretical physics, and then pertaining to freedom, right? And that's what we mean by a metaphysic of morals. So what is Kant doing here, right? What Kant is laying out is that, basically he's doing material pure philosophy with his metaphysics of morals, right? But he's also illustrated something else, right? And let's use physics as our example here, right? When we are doing empirical investigations, like, for example, do you remember back in, like, grade school, middle school, when out of popsicle sticks you were asked to build a bridge and glue it together and that sort of thing and create the heaviest load-bearing structure that you could? If you're anything like me, your bridge probably, when they attached the weight to it, shattered into a bunch of pieces, and every kid in the class went, whoa, right? Kant would point out that's because we are doing the empirical without the theoretical to ground it, right? So, right, what Kant is talking about here is that when we examine nature purely empirically, right, we are doing material empirical sort of investigations. Generally, we do so by trial and error, and generally we wind up screwing up a lot, right? Because we don't understand the abstract principles upon which our investigations are based, right? So it's a little bit like watching Curious George and watching him screw up and screw up and screw up and then finally figure it out. Those little thought bubbles that Curious George is having, as I've got kids, I watch a lot of Curious George, is him actually developing a theoretical understanding of his practical endeavors. Now, what Kant wants to argue is that in terms of human interaction and human freedom, we're no different than in terms of the physics, right? Practical anthropology generally tries to investigate human behavior, one, without drawing a judgment, and two, right, just purely observationally. We're just looking at the data, right, to see how people actually behave, right? Now, when we are engaged with a metaphysical sort of understanding of human behavior and human freedom, what we are looking for is the abstract laws that human behavior obeys, or the abstract rules that can sort of account for why we frequently don't behave the way that we should. So if we want to ground a should claim, what we need are a series of abstract principles that should or ought govern human behavior. Now, this is why Kant is looking for such a grounding, right, to a metaphysic of morals, the principle, that supreme principle of morality, which, if we can figure it out, right, allows us to first off make a strong "you should do this" claim, right? Secondly, right, it will allow us to evaluate human actions in terms of their moral worth, right? And, like, thirdly, it'll put to rest all moral quandaries. So, he tells us, page 3, by 390 there, middle of the page, a metaphysics of morals is thus indispensably necessary. not merely because the motives of speculation regarding the source of practical principles which are present a priori in our reason. So not only because we're curious about the underlying nature of our moral judgments, but because morals themselves are liable to all kinds of corruption as long as the guide and supreme norm for correctly estimating them are missing. For in the case of what it is to be morally good, that it conforms to the moral law is not enough. It must be done for the sake of the moral law. Otherwise, that conformity is only very contingent and uncertain, since the non-moral ground may now and then produce actions that conform with the moral law, but quite often produces actions that are contrary to the law. Now, the moral law in its purity and genuineness, which is of the utmost concern in the practical realm, can be sought nowhere but in pure philosophy. Therefore, pure philosophy metaphysics must proceed. Without it, there can be no moral philosophy at all. Just like empirical physics, engineering, for example, right, at building bridges that don't fall down, cannot proceed without a theoretical understanding. Right? Moral philosophy, practical dealings with one another, if they are going to be considered moral, must be preceded by a theoretical understanding. We must know the principle that we are acting upon. And for Kant, it's the principle at work that makes an action moral. Now, just to illustrate this claim of Kant's that I just read here, I'll just read it again. For in the case of what it is to be morally good, that it conforms to the moral law is not enough. It must be done for the sake of the moral law. Otherwise, that conformity is only very contingent and uncertain, since the moral law may now and then produce actions that conform with the, or since the non-moral ground may now and then produce actions that conform with the moral law, but quite often produces actions that are contrary to the law. Now, let me just quickly illustrate something here. And for this, I need a little bit of chalkboard space for a little illustration that I have been using for a long time here. Right? Now, I used to work at the University of Windsor on staff before I started my teaching career. Actually, right at the beginning of my teaching career, when I was first teaching this material, I would also work at the library. And the library at the University of Windsor is open very late, so the only way I was able to get through my shift, which was a night shift, was coffee. Right? Well, this one day I walked into the area in front of the cafe, all right, that was in the library, trying to get my bloody coffee, and there was all of this fanfare. There were news junkets, right, from print media, from radio, from television, and a stage set up, the president and the provost of the university, along with a couple of suits from some major automotive corporation, and a girl standing in the middle holding a check that big for $1,200, looking very nervous, and you know, sort of happy. So I was trying to figure out exactly what the heck was going on. Well, the student turned out to be a student with the appropriate grades, of the appropriate demographic, from the automotive engineering department. And this major auto corporation was sponsoring her, right? Giving her a stipend, some sort of a scholarship, right? For $1,200. And I thought to myself, that's nice. That's nice for a number of reasons. One, these automotive corporations, to a certain extent, owe it to these students at the university that are investing heavily in studying and theorizing about automotive engineering, because the automotive companies rely on these people. Right. Plus, on top of that, students, as you know, are financially hard done by. Right? So they need all the support that they can get. Right. So it's nice that someone, anyone, and especially these people that are somehow beneficiaries of people's studies, right? It's good that they give something back. Well, I got my coffee and I started thinking more clearly. I started thinking in Kantian terms. If this automotive company were doing this for the right reasons, because they felt it was their duty to do so, because, well, I see on the one hand I rely on this behavior, and on the other hand, it seems clear that I have to support this behavior. Or three, because it's like just a good thing to do this, right? If they were doing this for the right reasons, why was the check this big? Why was every major media outlet in the city present? Right? Why didn't they just mail something that effectively is a partial textbook scholarship to this student, or deposit it in their student account? Why all the fanfare? Well, we can speculate with regard to the motives of the automotive company, and I'm sure some actuary in some office somewhere has determined that giving this small an amount of money to a student in this manner is a whole lot of free advertising. That's a whole lot of free advertising that the corporation gets. Not quite free, but cheap, ridiculously cheap. And what they hope to gain from the press coverage, from the media attention, from the perception of goodwill, right, is worth to them way more than the cost of this jumbo check. Right? So effectively, right, it seemed that we could isolate as a motive for this particular action something other than duty, something other than the goodwill that stands behind it. Right? Now, what Kant is getting at here is that, you know, in this one case, it produced an action that I think we would all agree is good, that it conforms with the moral law, that it lines up with the duties of the company. Right? But quite frequently, we can picture situations where major automotive companies operating from the same principles, the generation of profit for shareholders, will do actions that violate that moral law, acting on the same non-moral principle that produced this particular action. For example, installing software that beats emissions tests, right? For example, failing to do recalls when those recalls are necessary and warranted. Right? So, that an action conforms with the moral law is not enough, argues Kant. If we really want to require that people do the right thing, it's not enough that they do the right thing for the motive of profit, or the motive of private benefit. Since these motives, sometimes they have us doing the right thing, but quite frequently they have us, these motives, these principles that we act upon, will have us violate that which we would consider a good action. Right? So an action for Kant, in order to have any moral worth whatsoever, must be done not just in conformity with our duty, but for the sake of duty. Kant calls it out of reverence for the moral law. He wants you not just to do the right thing, but do the right thing for the right reasons. Because if you're not doing it for the right reasons, it doesn't count. It doesn't count. Right? So this is Kant's very strict sort of requirement for morality. Right? It's not enough that we do the right thing. We have to do the right thing for the right reasons. And that didn't pause. Okay, grounding, first section. Now, what Kant starts off by saying here is that there's no possibility, and this is your page 7, of anything at all in the world, or even out of it, which can be regarded as good without qualification except a good will. Right? The only good in itself is a good will, according to Kant. Right? Now, he gives us several examples here. Intelligence, wit, judgment, and whatever talents of the mind one might want to name are doubtless good in many respects, and desirable as each as are such qualities as temperance, courage, or temperament as courage, resolution, perseverance, but they can become extremely bad and harmful if the will, which is to make use of these gifts of nature, and which in its special constitution is called character, is not good. Right? So what Kant is arguing here is that the only good that can be considered as unqualifiedly good rests in the will, not in a talent, not in a temperament, not in anything along those lines. So this is sort of a knock at Aristotle, who wants to call these virtues as intrinsically valuable and extrinsically valuable, right? What Kant wants to do is rest his consideration of the moral worth of every human quality and every human action in the will. That is, the manner in which the will arrives at its decision, right? So, largely, right, what Kant wants to point out here is that, you know, an example, and I hate to go straight to the Nazi example, as in my debate club was forbade because it was just arguing from paradigm case. You can't do that, right? But I can picture German soldiers in World War II as being courageous, extremely courageous, which Aristotle defines as a virtue. I mean, they'd have to be, wouldn't they? Right? So courage is not a good in itself. Any of the virtues that Aristotle points out are virtues are not goods in themselves, but rather the goodness of these qualities that express themselves extrinsically, right, is determined not by, you know, the quality themselves, but rather by the will, the intention that wields them. Right? So what Kant further wants to argue here is that these qualities, right, insofar as they are evaluated in terms of their intentions, right, even if they fail to achieve their ends, they are still, right, evaluated in terms of this will, hold their full moral value, right? So it's not the consequences of an action that are going to be the mode of evaluation for morality for Kant, right? He claims on the bottom of 7 over to the top of 8, a good will is not good because of what it affects or accomplishes, nor because of its fitness to attain some proposed end. So it's not the outcome of the action. It's only good through its willing. That is, it is good in itself. When considered in itself, when it is to be esteemed very much higher than anything which it might ever bring about merely in order to favor some inclination or even the sum total of inclinations. Even if by some especially unfortunate fate or by the niggardly provision of stepmotherly nature, I'll pause here to, Kant's use of that term, niggardly, simply means ineffective. So even if the will is ineffective, he's not making a racist claim here, right? Even if this will should be wholly lacking in the power to accomplish its purpose, if with the greatest effort it should yet achieve nothing, and only the good will shall remain, he qualifies that a little bit, not to be sure as a mere wish, but as the summoning of all the means in our power, yet would it, like a jewel, still shine by its own light, which has its full value in itself. Its usefulness or fruitfulness, can neither augment or diminish this value. Its usefulness would be, as it were, only the setting to enable us to handle it in ordinary dealings or to attract it to the attention of those who are not experts in the metaphysic of morals, but not to recommend it to real experts or to determine its value. So, this is an important aspect of Kantian philosophy. Right? He doesn't care about the outcomes of our actions. The result of our actions is not how he evaluates the moral worth of our actions, only in terms of the intentions behind our actions. Does a moral act become a moral act? Right? We've already had hints of this. An action must be performed for the sake of duty. That's how we determine that it is a moral action. The outcome doesn't add anything. Just to quickly illustrate here, picture rescue workers entering a rescue situation, firemen beating down doors, ambulance drivers putting themselves at risk in order to attempt to save lives. What Kant wants to do is give those actions, regardless of the outcome, their full moral worth. Right? Now, the next theorist that we're turning to, John Stuart Mill, and his teacher, Jeremy Bentham, right? Well, they're going to evaluate the moral worth of an action only in terms of its outcome. So, for Bentham and Mill, if a fireman kicks down a door and enters a burning building in order to save a family, yet fails to do so, or worse, themselves become seriously injured or dies, Bentham and Mill want to withhold the category hero from these people. Their actions, in fact, insofar as they failed to produce the desired end, have no moral worth whatsoever. None. And this I tend to think is a superiority of Kantian moral philosophy, because I don't know about you, but I want to say that rescue worker who tried, summoned all of their energy and their passion in order to attempt to save a family, deserve to be considered heroes. People in the military are fallen soldiers. Insofar as they've fallen and failed to achieve their targets, failed to achieve their ends, those actions have no moral worth whatsoever, right? According to a teleological. In fact, what Mill and Bentham would argue is that the actions of these soldiers actually, the result of the action diminishes the moral worth of the situation insofar as it's actually created more suffering. Right, made the situation worse, heightened the tragedy. Right, but for Kant, by evaluating the action only in terms of the intention behind the action, he maintains a certain level of moral value for these kinds of actions. Right, so. This is how it's not in terms of the outcome of an action that an action is assessed, right? It's only the intention behind the action, right? That gives the action moral worth, which is to say, it's only the putting into action the proper moral principle, right? That allows an action to be regarded for Kant as something that has any moral worth whatsoever. You've got to do the right thing for the right reasons, and if that's what you're doing, regardless of the outcome of the action, you've done a good thing. Right? Whereas, for Bentham and Mill, you could be enacting their principle, but if you fail the action, insofar as you failed and perhaps made the situation worse, it's either got no moral worth or actually negative moral worth. Right? So that's what Kant is arguing here. Now, just to further illustrate, what he does is he wants to lay out the three primary motive forces in a human being. Right? These are the forces that lead us to make the decisions that we make. And he identifies three of them that should be fairly familiar to us. Reason, the intellectual faculty of reason. Our will, the expression of our freedom that helps us make a decision. That's where the decision rests, right? And then desire or inclination. Right? These are the three forces that we waver in terms of. Either reason acts upon the will or inclination acts upon the will. Either you do it because you want to, or you do it because reason tells you you should. Now, what Kant wants to argue is that in the constitution of any organized being, we should find no organ within that creature which does not actually make it most fit to achieve its desired end. Now, what Kant wants to argue here, what Kant does argue here, is that if happiness, right, and we'll use Bentham and Mill's definition of happiness, pleasure in the absence of pain, were our goal, right? If we were fit to achieve this end, inclination alone would be a sufficient organ, right? We'd be all set in that, right? It helps us determine what we want and avoid what we don't want. We want pleasure and we don't want pain. We want, you know, to revel in joy. We don't want to suffer, etc., etc. An inclination would be a sufficient organ for that. But, I mean, you should consult your experience too. How many situations have you been in where what you wanted comes up against this notion of should? Reason tells you, oh, I really shouldn't. Right? I really shouldn't do that. Right? What Kant wants to point out is that reason and the will frequently frustrate inclination. And he points out that, in fact, quite frequently, what we wind up is in a situation where we actually hate this faculty of reason. Right? I've got that little voice in my head that I just want to kill. Right? So he points this out on the bottom of page 8. And in fact, we find that the more cultivated reason devotes itself to the aim of enjoying life and happiness, the further does man get away from true contentment. Because of this, there arises in many persons, if they're only candid enough to admit it, a certain degree of mislogy, a hatred of reason. This is especially so in the case of those who are most experienced in the use of reason, because after calculating all the advantages they derive, I say, not from the invention of all of the acts of common luxury, but even from the sciences, which in the end seem to them to be also a luxury of the understanding, they yet find that they have in fact only brought more trouble on their heads than they've gained in happiness. Right? So quite frequently, reason and the will tell you not to act in terms of inclination. Now I got this voice in my head I just want to kill. Right? So quite frequently, right, what we find is that if we were beings designed to seek after happiness, which Aristotle and Bentham and Mill want to argue that we are, reason would be an incredibly poor faculty to devote to this task. Right? So what Kant wants to surmise here is that, in fact, there is some other purpose that we're designed to aim at. It's built right into us, and that purpose is duty. We should do our duty. We should do what reason tells us to do. Now, effectively, what Kant is arguing here is that inclination shows itself to be sort of a free rider. When we get to the formulations of the categorical imperative, the word inclination is in brackets there because the formulations of the categorical imperative are just basically complicated ways of bracketing your desires, your inclinations, your benefit out of the equation and allowing reason to figure out what it is our duty is and act on the will so that we will do it. All right? So to further illustrate this, what Kant winds up doing is laying out four cases, and you find these on pages 10 over to 12, just the top of 12, of various actions considered with regard to duty. The first is those actions that are contrary to duty, you know, lying, cheating, stealing, that sort of thing. And we know that these are morally worthless kinds of actions. They're just worthless. We know they're contrary to duty, right? So he tosses those aside right off the bat. Then there are those actions that are sort of a mix of duty plus self-seeking inclinations. You volunteer in order to pad your resume, right? You are nice to people so that they will vote for you, or so that they will give you a job, right? Et cetera, et cetera, right? So you're doing what you're supposed to do, but you're doing it because, or at least you have this inclination for your long-term benefit that occasions you to do these sorts of things. He uses the example, if you pay your taxes, not because you know you should pay into the system and support the system that you depend upon because it's your fair share, but because you're afraid of getting into legal and financial trouble for not having done so. So duty plus self-seeking inclinations. Now, the third case is duty plus immediate inclination. You're doing what you're supposed to do, and you're having a great time doing it. Right? You're volunteering at a soup kitchen because you think it's the most fun way to spend a Friday night. Right? You're helping your friend move because it's always a blast to help your friend move. There's beer, there's pizza, all of your other friends are there, etc., etc. It turns into a great party. And it's not such a bad thing to get some exercise. It feels good to burn those calories, right? So you're doing the right thing, but you also have a great time doing it. And then finally, the case that is the one that Kant identifies as the only clear-cut example of an action that has any moral worth so whatsoever is duty alone. That is, contrary to both self-seeking inclinations and immediate inclinations. You really just don't feel like it. And not only is it not going to benefit you, but it's contrary to your long-term benefits. You know you should do this. You don't want to. And it's going to hurt you in the long term. In class, I have some examples of this. There was an example where I was overpaid at a job that I'd quit, right? They paid me for a whole extra week, and it was a lot of money. In itself, that week was a year of tuition, right? It was a lot of money. I was working at a factory at night shift, time and a half, and then double time on top of that, and that sort of thing. It was a big chunk of money. So when I was evaluating what I should do, well, unfortunately, I was taking this class and studying Kant at the time. Right? And I knew, oh boy, I wanted to keep that money. Right? And in fact, I knew it would help me in the long run to keep that money. It would be enjoyable to have that sum of money in the bank. I could do a lot of fun things with it. And it would be to my extreme long-term benefit to keep it. But then I asked myself, did I earn that money? Was I the person standing on the line doing that work? Right. Did my labor produce these funds? And contrary to all inclination, I determined that no, I can't keep this money. Right. I did not even get a thank you for returning it. In fact, they made it quite a living hell for me to return this money to the company because I was doing the right thing. There's not even the I get to look good in front of my peers kind of thing, right? Boy, you're honest. You're very honest, and congratulations for that. It was, don't let the door hit you on your way out. Now, recently I've become father of twins, and case four, anybody who's got kids knows that case four, is, for a parent, a case that you find yourself visiting a lot, right? You don't want to get up at 3 a.m. to take care of your sick kid. It's not something you're inclined to do. And what's more, you know that you're undermining your ability to do your job. You're undermining your ability to effectively get through the next day. So in terms of your long-term goals, I mean, brass tacks, kids are an interruption to your career and to your plans and that sort of thing. Yet, at the same time, after your kid's been screaming at you for 6 or 7 hours straight, you can't comfort them, and they're throwing up all over the place, and you're changing diaper after diaper after diaper after diaper, you know bloody well you're not inclined to do this either. But what do? You do it, right? That's the way I've been explaining it, right? And the funny thing that I'm explaining is that, you're doing your duty. Contrary to all of your inclinations, duty doesn't care if you want to do what you're doing. Now, Kant claims that case four is the only clear-cut case, right? But Kant isn't advocating that we should actually seek out as many as cases of number four as we could find just to test our virtue. Your translator, right, in footnote, it's on page 11, but the note starts on page 10, it's footnote number 4, describes it this way. I'm starting on page 11 here. Case 4 involves those actions which accord with duty but are contrary to some immediate inclination. One does not commit suicide, for example, even when he is in dire distress. One does not commit adultery, even though his wife has turned into an impossible shrew, etc. That was a bit of a knock at Socrates, who married a woman by the name of Xanthippe, right? Who, he described as an impossible shrew, and he described his marrying her in order to test his possible virtue, right? So, now, case four is the crucial test of the will's possible goodness, right? It's the only clear-cut case, right? In case two or in case three, we're not sure. Sure, the action accords with duty, but we also get something out of it. Either we enjoy it or we have some sort of long-term benefit. You can't be sure in case two and three why you were doing the right thing. And remember back at the beginning, an action must be done for the sake of the moral law to have any moral worth, right? So case four is the only clear-cut example, or as your translator puts it now, case four is the crucial test of the will's possible goodness. But Kant does not claim that one should lead his life in such a way as to encounter as many such cases as possible in order to constantly test his virtue. For example, to do what Socrates did, deliberately marry a shrew as to be able to resist the temptation to commit adultery. Life forces enough such cases on a person without his seeking them out. But when there is a conflict between duty and inclination, duty should always be followed. Case three makes for the easiest and easiest living and greatest contentment, and anyone would wish that life might present him with far more of these cases than with case two or four. But yet, one should not arrange his life in such a way as to avoid case four at all costs, and to seek out case three as much as possible. Become a recluse, for example, as to avoid the possible rough and tumble involved with frequent associations of one's fellows. Avoid places where one might encounter the sick and the poor so as to spare oneself the pangs of sympathy and the need to exercise the virtue of benefiting those in distress, etc. For the purpose of philosophical analysis, Kant emphasizes case four as being the test case of the will's possible goodness, but he's not thereby advocating Puritanism.
All right. So, effectively, what Kant wants to argue is that when reason and inclination get into a fight, reason should always win. All right? Or here's a truism for you. At any point when there is a conflict between what you want to do and what you should do, you should always do what you should do. Insofar as it's a should claim, it's almost a truism. Right? Now, there are all sorts of examples of case four. Right? Political martyrs, guaranteed, don't want to be political martyrs, but they are standing up for their principles because they feel they have a duty to stand up to their principles, not because it's convenient or beneficial or anything along those lines. It'd be interesting to think through Snowden in terms of Kantian morality, right? Or to think about the guy who throws himself on a grenade to save his buddies. Right? There was in the Captain America First Avenger an example where Rogers threw himself on a grenade. Get back to save everybody. Not because he's suicidal, not because he wanted to die, but because he felt he had a duty to do so. Right? And in that case, we call that courage. Right? So, now, what Kant wants to do ultimately here, right, is to lay out the first formulation of the categorical imperative. That's as far as he gets in the first section. I'm just going to get some room here, and I'm going to write it down. We'll return to it in the second section and take a look at two more, but for our purposes here, it reads, and you can find it on page 14, right below 402. I should never act except. I should never act except in such a way that I can always will the maxim, that my maxim. Except in such a way that I can will my maxim. Should become a, if I can sit now, universal law. This is the first formulation of the categorical imperative. Now, what Kant is getting at here, right, is that when we are evaluating the way that we should act, right, what we should do is start by isolating the maxim of our actions, the principle under which we are acting, right? The abstract. And, you know, it's when we isolate a maxim, there's no I involved. There's no you involved. There's no context involved. What we are looking for is the abstract principle that stands behind the action. Right? Another way to think of this is the first formulation acts, it puts you in a situation where you are yourself asking if everybody should, in principle, act as you are about to act. Right? That's what it's asking here. Right? So you're isolating the abstract principle that stands behind your action. Now, Kant furnishes us with an example here, and this is why this is why I say that Kant has actually learned how to write here. We've actually bloody well got an example. I'm sorry, I have to sneeze. No, I stifled it. All right. Now, he pictures a situation where somebody is in dire need of a sum of money. Tell the payday, let's say. Right. Yet they know at payday there's no way that they are going to be able to pay back the money that they are about to attempt to borrow. Though at the same time they know that they won't get the loan unless they promise to pay it back at payday. So, that is a false promise. Is it acceptable to offer a false promise? In principle, is it acceptable to issue false promises? Well, this works this way. Right? You know bloody well you need the money. You know you're inclined to issue the false promise in order to get the money that you need. Right? Because you have these needs. Right? But if you are evaluating that action morally, right, you should ask, is it right to offer such a false promise? Now, what he's telling us here, right, and keep in mind, this is a command. There's no, well, if you want this, then that, like we would find in Aristotle, or we are about to find in John Stuart Mill. Right? This is a categorical imperative. It is a command, right, that says, I should never act except in such a way that I can will the maxim of my action should become a universal law. Now, think it through. Not in terms of its consequences, but rather, what would happen? Would it make any rational sense whatsoever to have a universal law that encourages false promise making? Well, Kant points out that the entire, there are a few ways to think this through. Kant points out that the entire edifice of promise making would fall apart if they were all false. Truth is entailed logically in the notion of a promise. So if a promise is false, it's not a promise. There's a logical contradiction right within there, and you already know, right in the nature of the action, that it is incorrect to issue a false promise. Here's another way to think about it, and your translator points this out as well. Right? If we all operated on the basis of a law that says issue false promises. It says we should issue false promises. Well, your lie wouldn't work, your false promise wouldn't work, and you wouldn't get what you want. Because if you issued a false promise to me and we lived under a situation where there was a universal law that all promises should be false, I wouldn't believe you, and I wouldn't loan you the money. Right? It negates all of the possible advantage that comes out of promising, which shows that really, when we issue a false promise, we are just making an exception to the general rule that says we should tell the truth just for ourselves, or just this one time. Right? We know that it is inclination at work. Right? And you see, this formulation of the categorical imperative, this first formulation of the categorical imperative, would have us, bracket that inclination out of the mix. So that's how Kantian moral philosophy works. All right, sorry about that. That is one of the drawbacks with teaching from home. The phone rings sometimes,
As you know, people's phones ring in class sometimes, but it's I don't have to answer other people's phones. If nobody's answering mine, it goes to message, and we hear the message, and it's private, and I don't want you hearing that. So what we're going to do, that was sufficient for the first section. We saw this first formulation of the categorical imperative, and practically what Kant wants to do is bracket inclination out of our moral choice-making altogether, right? Because inclination is, for Kant, the only reason we would do really nasty things. Now, this is an interesting feature of Kantian morality, too, because unlike the other moral theorists that we've looked at so far, what we find in the ancients is a particular notion of human nature, right? One in which we are all basically good creatures. So, in a sense, if we understand what the good is, we're all automatically inclined to do it, right? This came out quite clearly in our treatment of the Socratic dicta. Knowledge is virtue. Those that know the good automatically do the good, and evil only arises as an involuntary error due to ignorance. The only reason people do nasty, hurtful, stupid, wrong-headed, jerky kinds of things is because they don't know any better. That's fairly direct in Socratic ethics. In Aristotle, what we looked at is that right within our essence, there is a potential that should be actualized towards a condition of flourishing, right? Which is the good life, which is happiness, right? So if we really want the sorts of things that we want in the right way and really think about what the right way is, then we become virtuous, good people who do fine actions, right? Now, what the moderns actually have noticed, right, is that, and specifically Kant has noticed, is that, quite frankly, in a lot of cases, doing the right thing is not going to personally benefit us, right? So if our interests are always that which is at stake, if our interests are the only thing that grounds our moral disposition, quite frankly, our interests are going to lead us frequently to do wrong things, jerky things, selfish things, rather than the good, right? There's nothing within us, a chocolatey center of goodness, that is just waiting to be expressed, except insofar as we've got this faculty of reason, which is reveals to us the moral truth, right? Effectively, that's what Kant is grounding all of this in. If there is a metaphysic of morals, that means there is a right and wrong that can be held to be true. And largely what Kant is doing by introducing these formulations of the categorical imperative is enabling us to use our own reason to discover this moral truth that holds always and everywhere for everyone. Right? So what Kant has noticed, unlike Socrates and Aristotle, and unlike the arguments that we're going to see from Bentham and Mill to a certain extent, there's sort of a widgety way that we're going to take a look at when we turn to Bentham and Mill. But nonetheless, what he's noticed is that sometimes doing the right thing is just going to suck. Sometimes it's going to suck. You're not going to want to do it. You're not going to get anything out of it. But doing the right thing is still right. Right? So what Kant is doing, laying out his grounding to the metaphysic of morals, is spelling out what your duty is, right? What your duty is, right? And what should you do in any given situation, what you're inclined to do, or your duty? Your duty. You are obligated morally to do your duty, right? Even though you don't want to, even though it's inconvenient, even though it doesn't serve your own self-serving motives, you do it because it's the right thing to do, he says, out of reverence for the moral law, right? So in the second section, he's going to start off with a critique, a possible critique of his position, right? From a group that he loosely defines as the self-love moralists, right? He's not real specific about who he's talking to here, right? But nonetheless, we can think this through when we turn to Mill and see if Mill and Bentham actually fit into this category, right?
Then what he's going to do is take a much closer look at this first formulation of the categorical imperative, because it seems clear that sometimes we're going to have duties that conflict, right? So he's going to add in a mechanism with regard to the first formulation and the second formulation that allowed us to sort of parse out these conflicting duties by just observing a scale of stronger and weaker sorts of moral obligation that he articulates in terms of perfect and imperfect duties. He's going to give us lots of examples, well, four examples that he's going to use twice for this particular distinction, which is an important one for Kantian morality. Then he's going to introduce his demanding notion of freedom, which Michael Sandel does an excellent job of introducing to you in that video, the Mind Your Motive video that I did from his Justice series, right? So turn to that. I'm going to introduce it very briefly. Michael Sandel does an excellent job of introducing it. And since you're responsible for that too, it's your duty to watch that video, right? So do it, right? And then finally, we're going to take a look at what he calls the kingdom of ends, right? And this has confused a lot of theorists for a long time, including Bentham and Mill, right? But I think I have a decent way to explain it that makes a bit of sense, right? So at very least, it rests in the argument we find in Kant, right? And seems to be a way to make it clear and concise, right? Clear and distinct in our minds, kind of thing. Now, I'm going to start off by pointing, I've got three formulations of the categorical imperative on the board here, right? Really, there are five. There are minor variations on one and two that count as the third, like the additional two that we're not taking a look at, right? It's add of nature into the first formulation of the categorical imperative, and you get the second formulation, right? And then there's a funny additional sort of minor variation on the second formulation as well. I think it's sufficient for our purposes if we take a look at the three major movements, rather than at the minutiae of all five. There are important distinctions, and if you go on studying philosophy and specifically ethics of Kant, right, there are important distinctions to be had here. But for an introductory account, I think we are good with three. Right, these are categorical imperatives. They're commands. They're not hypothetical imperatives, which are suggestions, right? If you want a clean car, then do X, Y, and Z, right? If you want to do well in school, then study, study, do your reading, show up for your tests, give yourself plenty of time, etc., etc., right? Because hypothetical imperatives, insofar as they're strong suggestions, if-then statements, well, they do not hold the kind of sway that we want a moral claim to hold, right? These are categorical claims. There's no wiggle room. There's no, well, if you want this, then that, right? These are do this, do that, do the other thing. It's your duty, right? It's not optional to do these sorts of things, right? It is required. It is your duty, right? So that's why Kant articulates these in terms of commands. Now, he's got a minor distinction between kinds of hypothetical imperative. Generally, hypothetical imperatives aim at a particular kind of task, right? Like I give you a couple of, examples there, right? But there are imperatives of felicity as well, right, that aim at happiness. And if we had a determinate concept of happiness, Kant argues that, you know, really, right, all of these imperatives of felicity would be in exactly the same sort of structure as all of the hypothetical imperatives. In any case, neither of them are commands, right? So everything that Bentham and Mill are about to argue, right, is hypothetical, right? If you want to be happy, then you should be moral, right? Again, back to Aristotle, if you want to be happy, then you should be virtuous, right? Kant is just simply saying, do your duty, right? It's more direct and it's a simple kind of command. And recall for Kant, the only action, and I said this just minutes ago in the previous video, that has any moral worth whatsoever is that commanded independently of inclination, right? And, you know, resting solely in the principle that reveals your duty, right? So you're doing the right thing because it's the right thing, not because you get something about it, not out of self-love, for example. The second section begins with a possible criticism, and Kant wants to head it off right away, right? That comes from a group of philosophers that he calls self-love moralists, who argue that in all of human history, there has never been a single case of Kant's case for those actions that accord with duty but are contrary to all inclination. Right. They would argue that there is always some more or less refined sort of self-love. Right. So anytime I do something that is counter to all of my inclinations, I'm doing it not out of duty, but perhaps motivated by pride or some form of dignity, right, or some sort of long-term, I'll get something out of it, right? In the case of doing things for my children, right, it may be, to follow Dawkins' argument, for example, to allow my genes to perpetuate themselves, right? So for the idea of some sort of biological immortality or something along those lines, right? I'm doing the right thing not out of duty, but to have an example to explain Kantian duty, and that undermines any sort of example I might give you here, right? So these self-love moralists speculate that there is always something you get out of it, right? In each and every case that we can examine of a human action, we can always reveal some form of self-love lurking in the background, right? Well, this would seem to pose a big problem to Kantian morality, right? But, right, Kant wants to respond, and this is on page 20. And I'm jumping in mid-sentence right below 408, right? The question at issue here is whether or not this or that has happened, but that reason of itself, independently of all experience, commands what ought to happen. Consequently, reason unrelentingly commands actions of which the world has perhaps hitherto never provided an example, and whose feasibility might well be doubted by one who bases everything upon experience. For instance, even though there might never yet have been a sincere friend, still pure sincerity in friendship is nonetheless required of every man, because this duty, prior to all experience, is contained as duty in general in the idea of reason that determines the will by means of a priori grounds. That is, if you really look at the principle of your action, your duty is clear. Right, it's laid out there, right? And sure, perhaps no human being has ever acted in terms of case four, duty alone contrary to all inclination. Perhaps that has never happened, right? Let's first use his example, pure sincerity and friendship. Perhaps all of my friends, every single one of them, all of your friends, every single one of them, all of everybody's friendships, every single one of them are motivated by self-seeking ends of some sort. You hang out because you enjoy their company. You hang out because it increases your social standing. You hang out because it gives you some sort of professional leg up, etc., etc., etc. Perhaps that is the motivation behind all friendships. but Kant is still in a position to say it shouldn't be, because the definition of friendship entails sincerity. And here's another example. Let's say, and this is a thought experiment, that in every single marriage, and I mean marriage in terms of the sort of North American standard of marriage, right, where one promises to be faithful and it's a contract, and faithfulness is an explicit promise, right? Perhaps in every single marriage ever, one or the other partner has been unfaithful. And let's even say that both, in every bloody one, this is a thought experiment, we can open this up. Let's say everybody who's ever married has been unfaithful. You can define that however you like. Still, marriage rests in a promise to be faithful. Even if in every single marriage, every single married person has been unfaithful, that's still a violation of the general rule that exists as a promise at the heart of the marriage that says you're going to be faithful. So Kant is saying that even if such and such a thing has never happened, it should. You see, we're in that realm of the should here, right? And as Kant pointed out, what your duty is exists independent of all experience. So perhaps nobody has ever acted this way, but duty requires things of human beings that maybe human beings have never bloody well done. Right? So even if the self-moralists are right, there's never been such an action, right? Kantian morality still holds because it's in a position, right? The theoretical position that lays out our duty to say that even if these things don't happen, they should. Fairly simple response. Is it sufficient? I don't know. There are ways to argue that, and hopefully I'll give you the opportunity to get into an argument about that. Now, back to this first formulation of the categorical imperative, which I've formulated slightly differently than I did before, because Kant formulates it slightly differently than I had it before. We're jumping over some things. He makes the distinction between rules of skill, the hypothetical imperative that says if you want to do X, then do Y, and counsels of prudence, if you want to be happy, then do Y. Right, or commands, laws, that is categorical imperatives, don't lie, don't cheat, don't plagiarize, etc., etc., etc. The categorical imperatives are moral imperatives insofar as, for Kant, they issue commands, because duty is unconditional. It doesn't care what you feel like, right? So, right, what Kant does is returns to this first formulation of the categorical imperative, which on page 30 he lays out how I have it laid out here. Act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time will that it should be universal law. Now, what Kant wants to do is look at four different case studies, right, and illustrate in each of these case studies what our duty is. And at the same time as he's doing that, you're going to have to follow the footnotes because he's not ridiculously clear, right? I'm going to try and give you a roadmap with regard to how to distinguish between perfect and imperfect duties that I will almost certainly ask you a question about on the test, right? But anyhow, right, each of these case studies helps illustrate this distinction and how to use this first formulation of the categorical imperative. So let's just take a look at all four. This goes from page 30 to 32, where he lays out these cases. Right? The first one, I'll just read. A man reduced to despair by a series of misfortunes feels sick of life, but is still so far in possession of his reason that he can ask himself whether taking his own life would not be contrary to duty to himself.
Now, he asks whether the maxim of his action could become a universal law of nature. But his maxim is this, from self-love, I make as my principle. Two, and this is the principal part, shorten life when its continued duration threatens more evil than it promises in satisfaction. There only remains the question as to whether this principle of self-love can become a universal law of nature. Kant argues, and I'll quickly explain after, one sees at once a contradiction in a system of nature whose law would destroy life by means of the very same feeling that acts to stimulate the furtherance of life, and hence there could be no existence of a system of such a system of nature. Therefore, such a maxim cannot possibly hold as a universal law of nature and is consequently wholly opposed to the principle of duty. Right? So, we're to act only according to that maxim whereby you can at the same time will that it should become a universal law. Right? Now, that the maxim that we're evaluating here to ask if it could become a universal law is that one should shorten life when its continued duration threatens more evil than it promises in terms of satisfaction. Well, first off, there's a problem with that. It's influenced by inclination. Right? The principle involves inclination. So it cannot possibly operate in terms of the first formulation of the categorical imperative. Right? Now, atop that, right, what Kant wants to say is that when we isolate that maxim that we should kill ourselves, right, and turn that into a universal law, right, the maxim itself would refute itself because, well, think about it, we'd run out of people to act according to that maxim. Right? I have to say, the first formulation is not the best to think through this particular example, but nonetheless, right? Kant thinks that there is a rational contradiction in a principle that is supposed to stimulate life, actually calling for its end. Right? There's something irrationally contradicted. It refutes itself. Right? Second example we've already seen. Another man in need finds himself forced to borrow money. He knows that he won't be able to repay it, but he sees also that he will not get the loan unless he firmly promises to repay it within a fixed time. He wants to make such a promise, but he still has conscience enough to ask himself whether or not it's permissible, and whether it is not permissible and contrary to his duty to get out of difficulty in this way. Suppose, however, that he decides to do so. The maxim of his action would then be expressed as follows. When I believe myself to be in need of money, I will borrow money and promise to repay it all back, although I know I can never do so. I don't know why Kant formulated it that way, because that maxim has the personal pronoun all over it, right? We've already handled this, right? But really, right, it shows that what Kant is showing in each case is that the principle of self-love acting behind each of these decisions would have us do the immoral rather than the moral thing. The principle of self-love, inclination, in other words, would have us lie when we already bloody well know that that maxim is impossible to will as a universal law. The self-love principle is self-refuting. Right? I then transform the requirement of self-love into a universal law and put the question thus. How would things stand if my maxim were to become a universal law? He then sees at once that such a maxim could never hold as a universal law of nature and be consistent with itself, but must necessarily be self-contradictory. For the universality of such a law says that anyone believing himself to be in difficulty could promise whatever he pleases with the intention of not keeping it,
it would make promising itself and the end to be attained thereby quite impossible, inasmuch as one would believe that what was promised him, but would merely laugh at all such utterances being vain promises. Now, the key to take out of these first two examples, right, the person reduced to despair, right, say one should kill themselves, but the principle at work is a rational contradiction, right, because it would negate the very reason that brought it about. The person who wants to borrow money and issue the false promise sees at once this principle to be self-contradictory. There is a rational contradiction in the promise itself, in the principle itself. So, perfect duties, and your translator does a fair job of pointing this out, right, maintain the consistency of principles rationally. We have a perfect duty to preserve our own lives. We have a perfect duty to tell the truth, because violations of these principles would put us in a position where there is a rational contradiction. Right? The principle, when universalized, wouldn't make any bloody sense. It would be self-contradictory. Now, moving on to the third. A third finds himself a talent whose cultivation would make him a man useful in many respects. Let's say you've got a talent at the kind of science necessary to cure Alzheimer's or cancer or something along those lines. But he finds himself in a comfortable circumstances and prefers to indulge in pleasure rather than to bother himself about broadening and improving his fortunate natural aptitudes, playing Xbox and eating potato chips instead. But he asks himself further whether his maxim of neglecting his natural gifts, besides agreeing of itself with his propensity to indulge, might also agree with what is called duty. He then sees that a system of nature could indeed always subsist according to such a universal law, even though every man, like so sea islanders, should let his talents rust and resolve to devote his life entirely to idleness, indulgence, propagation, and, in a word, enjoyment. Right? So, there's no rational contradiction in terms of letting your talents rust. What if everybody were to allow their talents to rust? Right? What if this became a universal law? Well, it would still exist. Right? There are parts of the world, he points to the South Sea Islanders, right, which is a climate and, you know, a zone, as he understands it, in terms of nature, where food is plentiful. You don't need much in the way of shelter. You don't much need culture to rely on, kind of thing. It's a pleasant enough kind of climate and situation where you can just conceivably lie about all day, made enough to propagate the species, and just enjoy yourself. Right? Doesn't matter. The species would still survive. There's nothing contradictory to a system of nature that can operate in terms of just sitting on your butt. Right? So, right? Test number one. Does it make any rational sense whatsoever? Yeah. You know, such a maxim is not self-contradictory in that way. But he continues. But he cannot possibly will that this should become a universal law of nature or be implanted in us as such by a law, by a natural instinct. For, as a rational being, he necessarily wills that all his faculties should be developed inasmuch as they're given to him for all sorts of possible purposes. You see, we have this word will in here as an additional factor with regard to this first formulation of the categorical imperative. And now picture yourself in such a life of enjoyment kind of thing. You're lazing around a beach, you've got enough food, there's nothing fancy about the food, but you eat it and subsist and that sort of thing because, well, you'd have to develop your talents if you wanted food to be better. Right? Now, you're laying on the beach, sitting in the sun, taking a swim. Well, no, you're not taking a swim, because that is a talent. That's a skill that you have to develop. Right? So, you're not taking a swim. Well, ultimately, you get bored. How about you play sports? Right? To entertain? No, that's a skill. You'd have to develop a talent. And if this were to hold as a universal law, you would be prohibited from developing your talents. Right? Now, let's say, fine, I'll just read or watch TV. Again, somebody would have to be skillful enough in language to write something, or inventive enough to develop the technology necessary for television, or, you know, maybe I listen to somebody tell a story or tell a story myself. Oh, again, talents, right? Everything that we enjoy in life relies upon cultures of people developing talents. Anything that's a cultural good, right? So, if we, even in a weak sense, enjoy that sort of thing out of life, we have an imperfect duty to develop our talents. Right? It's a contradiction of the will. Right? There are two aspects of this first formulation of the categorical imperative. First thing is, isolate your maxim, universalize it, and ask if that maxim would, you know, subsist rationally, or if there is some form of self-contradiction. Kant argues issuing a false promise is a contradictory act. It's rationally contradictory. Such a maxim could not stand because it would be self-contradictory. Again, killing yourself, that maxim could not exist because it is rationally self-contradictory. Whereas developing your talents, there's nothing rationally self-contradictory about that. You could picture it's thinkable, right? But nobody would want to live in such a world. Right? It would be impossible to will that that maxim should be a universal law. So what? The inverse, developing some of your talent some of the time, it's a weaker form of moral obligation, becomes another duty. How much of your talents? Right? Should you, you know, listen to the tiger mom and develop all of your talents all of the bloody time and leave no time for leisure and enjoyment and that sort of thing? No, Kant's not going that far. You have an imperfect duty, which is a weaker form of moral obligation, to develop some of your talent some of the time. Whereas, you always bloody well gotta do your perfect duties. Right? One more example to illustrate this. And I like this one. A fourth man finds things going well for himself, but sees others whom he could help, struggling with great hardships, and thinks, what does it matter to me? Let everybody be as happy as heaven wills, or as he can make himself. I'll take nothing from him, nor even envy him. But I have no desire to contribute anything to his well-being, or to his assistance when in need. Familiar? Should be fairly familiar. All right? If such a way of thinking were to become a universal law, Kant argues, a universal law of nature, the human race admittedly could well subsist, and doubtless could subsist even better than when everybody prates about sympathy and benevolence, and even on occasion exerts himself to practice them, but on the other hand also cheats when he can, betrays the rights of man, or otherwise violates them. But even though it's possible that a universal law of nature could subsist in accordance with that maxim, I'll pause right there. Picture a situation where everybody does their perfect duties, right? They don't lie, they don't cheat, they don't steal, they don't murder, because murder is wrong for the same reason suicide is wrong, kind of thing. You couldn't universalize a maxim and have that hold as a universal law. There's a rational contradiction. People do all of their perfect duties. They live up to their obligations. But nothing else. Nothing else. So, you know, when you're stuck in a parking lot and your car won't start, nobody's got a perfect duty to help you out. because it's kind of everyone for themselves. So you're stuck in a parking lot. Right? Let's say you fall on the street and break your leg. Nobody broke your leg for you, but they are perfectly within their perfect duty, right, to walk straight past you. Right? So sympathy, benefiting others, that sort of thing. Right? If nobody did that, yet nobody lied, cheated, or harmed one another, right, we might even be better off than this sort of wishy-washy, sometimes we prate about sympathy and helping others and even exert ourselves, yet we also lie, cheat, stab, kill, maim, that sort of thing. Right? Such a world where everybody did their perfect duties might even be better than the world we live in. But would you want to live in a world devoid of that kind of compassion? No. Because, as Kant points out, it's still impossible to will that such a principle should hold everywhere as a law of nature. For a will which resolved in this way would contradict itself, inasmuch as cases might often arise in which one would have need of love and sympathy of others, and in which he would deprive himself by such a law of nature springing from his own will of all hope of the aid he wants for himself. Right? So we have a contradiction of the will. So the inverse then becomes an imperfect duty. So for the first formulation of the categorical imperative, we turn first to reason to determine our perfect duties. First thing we do is ask, you know, would such a principle or maxim, when universalized, even make sense? If it's no, then we know what we're considering is a violation of our perfect duties. And the inverse, telling the truth, not killing ourselves, etc., becomes a perfect duty. But then when we go one step further, right, and find that maybe there's no rational contradiction going on, we ask ourselves, well, what would such a principle holding always and everywhere extract? Right? So in the case of people developing their talents, we enjoy a lively culture of developed talents and even rely on it to some extent. Right? The scientist who's good at curing viral diseases, right, is somebody that we rely upon. Should everybody become a scientist? Good at curing viral diseases? Everybody who's even capable of that? No. No, there's no strong moral requirement that if you've got this talent, you have to use it in this way. But there's a weaker moral requirement that, you know, we develop some of our talent some of the time. Right? We rely on the fact that somebody develops that talent. So we have a requisite duty to develop some of our talents. Do we have a strong moral requirement to help every bloody person? I mean, I was recently in Toronto, right? And there is a homeless problem and a panhandler community in Toronto, right? A big one. So you're walking down the streets of Toronto. If you're walking down Yonge Street and you gave, let's say, even something small, like a quarter to each and every panhandler, you'd be broke by the end of the fifth block. There are a lot of people. There are a lot of people to help. So you can't yourself be expected to help everyone, which is why he says it's a weaker sort of moral obligation. You've got an imperfect duty to help some people some of the time. So when perfect duties and imperfect duties are in conflict with one another, you always do your perfect duties. You sometimes do your imperfect duties. Makes sense, I hope. Right? Now, what Kant wants to do is move from this first formulation of the categorical imperative to a second formulation of the categorical imperative. And in order to do that, he's got to do a little bit of rational acrobatics, right? So what he's got here is a complicated way of bracketing out your inclination, right, and revealing your duty, right? These are laws independent of all experience. Remember, we're just thinking about the principle of the thing, not about the consequences of the action. We're not engaging in practical anthropology. We're not saying most people most of the time act this way, so that must be moral, right? What we are doing, right, is a metaphysic of morals, right? We're dealing in abstract principles. Principles, as he says, laid out a priori, independent of all experience. So, we found one, universalization. That's pretty good. But we need another. Why do we need another? Because we are imperfect creatures who need a number of ways to think about things in order to make them clear to us. It's unfortunate, right? But nonetheless, right, it's subjectively necessary to lay this out in a number of ways. Now, this is where Sandel's treatment of autonomy and its, you know, distinction, its opposite, heteronomy, right, it becomes very handy. Kant's treatment of freedom, right, holds that we are only free when we act in terms of a law that we give to ourselves. And if you look at what we're doing with that first formulation of the categorical imperative, is there any reference to God or culture or anything except for our own faculties that we're referring to in its application? No, we're not. We are giving ourselves our own rules. Right? When we hold ourselves to this principle that we should only act according to that maxim whereby it can at the same time will that it become a universal law, effectively what we are doing is giving ourselves our own rules. It's our faculty of reason figuring out what our rules should be. But the interesting thing about it is that, so we are acting freely. For Kant, when we act on the basis of inclination, right, to, you know, sate hunger, for example, we don't have choice whether or not we sate hunger or thirst, right? When we are acting on the basis of inclination, we are acting according to something outside of ourselves, right? We are acting according to nature, according to Kant, right? The only time when we are really acting freely is when we are acting autonomously, and that amounts to giving ourselves rules in this manner. Now, the interesting thing that Kant wants to point out is that at the same time we are giving ourselves rules, we are effectively, on the basis of our reason, saying that anyone else who thinks about this using their faculty of reason should come to the same conclusion. So behind our acts that are occasioned according to that maxim whereby we can at the same time will that it should be a universal law, effectively, whenever we act, we are legislating universal law. We are saying, this doesn't only hold for me, it holds for you and any other being with a faculty of reason. So this is why Kant claims on 34, here philosophy must show its purity as author of its laws, and not herald of such laws that are whispered by an implanted sense or by who knows what tutelary nature. Right? Such laws may be better than nothing at all. It's not as though we're looking to nature. It's not as though we are discovering laws found out on some form of tablets. It's not as though something else is being handed to us. Do this, right? From on high, right?
What Kant says about such laws that are handed to us from on high is such laws may be better than nothing at all, but they can never give us principles directed by reason. These principles have an origin that is completely a priori from before, independent of experience, and must at the same time derive from such origin their authority and command. They expect nothing from the inclination of men, but rather expect everything from the supremacy of the law and from the respect owed to the law. Whether the latter expectation, without the latter expectation, these principles condemn man to self-contempt and inward abhorrence. Now, if we look closely at what we're doing, we are effectively legislating ourselves, each and every one of us, through the exercise of our normal human faculties, universal moral law that holds for everyone. Every time I come across a unique situation and discover a maxim that I can at the same time will to be a universal law, I'm not just privately willing that to be universal law, like it's good for me, but whatever's good for you. I'm saying that any rational animal, anyone, you, your brother, your cousin, that guy who panhandles on the streets of Detroit, the President of the United States, the Pope, everyone should act according to that universal law. Each and every one of us are capable of this. Every one of us. Right? So, if we're looking for something that has value independent of experience, right, that is a good in itself, like the goodwill, right, that has universal value, we found it. Humanity. Insofar as we are capable of being moral creatures, we are ends in ourselves. That is, insofar as we can act autonomously, which is, that's what we're doing when we act according to the first formulation of the categorical imperative, then we have a special value, a dignity that marks us off as different than tables and chairs and lamps and buildings and stones and trees and pieces of moss, that sort of thing. These things can't make moral choices. My cat cannot make a moral choice. Your dog cannot make, nor can an ox or an owl. Right? These things are not capable of legislating universal law. Right? Human beings, on the other hand, are capable of doing this. Kant reflects, page 35. And let us suppose there were something whose existence has in itself absolute worth, something which as an end in itself could be the ground of determinate laws. In it, and in it alone, there would be the ground for a possible categorical imperative, that is, a practical law. That's effectively what these are, right? These are practical imperatives. They're, insofar as they're commands, they're categorical. But these are practical principles that we can live our lives. Right? Now, he lays it out here. Now, I say that man, and in general, every rational being, exists as an end in himself, and not merely as a means to be arbitrarily used by this or that will. He must, in all his actions, whether directed to himself or directed to other beings, always be regarded at the same time as an end. All objects of inclinations have only conditioned value, right? This piece of chalk, for example, is only good for something, right? Human beings, on the other hand, are good in themselves, ends in themselves, right? For if there were not inclinations and the needs found in them, then their object would be without value. But the inclinations themselves, being sources of needs, are so far from having absolute value as to render them desirable for their own sake, that the universal wish for every rational being must be, rather, to be wholly free from them.
Accordingly, the value of any object obtainable by our action is always conditioned. Beings whose existence depends not on our will, but on nature, nevertheless, if they are not rational beings, have only relative value as means and are therefore called things. On the other hand, rational beings are called persons inasmuch as their nature already marks them out as ends in themselves, that is, as something which is not to be used merely as a means, and hence there is imposed thereby a limit on all arbitrary use of such beings, which are thus objects of respect. Persons are therefore not merely subjective ends whose existence as an effect of our actions has value for us, but such beings are objective ends, that is, exist in ends in themselves. This yields the second formulation of the categorical imperative. Act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or the person of another, always as an end and never simply or merely as a means. If we think through this, I need a paycheck. I'm using you. I'm using you right now. All right. I teach these courses. I do these things for these courses because I need a paycheck. I might not do them if I weren't paid to do so. All right. You're using me because you need a credit in this class. All right. So it seems that we use people all the bloody time. I use people at the checkout line in the grocery store or at the border crossing or my mechanic or my plumber or my electrician. We use people all the bloody time. But we never merely use people, or at least if this holds, we shouldn't simply use people. I know my plumbers by his first name. I always treat the checkout person with a certain degree of dignity. Right? I'm not enslaving these people. I'm giving them the respect that they deserve. Why? Because, as Kant points out, there is no morally relevant difference between any one of us and any other one of us. Insofar as we are beings that legislate universal law, we are marked out as different, beings with dignity, objects of respect, and therefore there is a limit on all arbitrary use of human beings. This is why sexual assault is wrong. It objectifies the person. It uses them simply as a means. Right? This is why enslaving is wrong, because it's using beings that are worthy of dignity and respect as mere means. Right? This might also prohibit murder. Right? Murdering a human being does not respect their dignity. That marks them off as ends in themselves. So that's the second formulation of the categorical imperative. And he points out, and if we return to the four cases, that it holds and comes to the same judgments as the first formulation. Right? It's just another way of thinking about the same principle. Right? So, act in such a way that you treat humanity, whether in your own person or the person of another, always as an end and never simply as a means. Now, think about the man thinking about committing suicide. Is he using himself as an end in himself when he is thinking about committing suicide? Well, interestingly, right, he's not respecting his rational autonomy when he does so. He points out that his life promises more evil than it does in satisfaction. He's not inclined to live. Right? But effectively, in doing so, he's treating his own person as a means to the end of enjoyment. So, he's in direct violation of the second formulation of the categorical imperative. He's treating himself merely as a means to an end. and not as an end in himself. What about if I issue you a false promise? I promise I'm going to be able to do this, and I know I'm not going to be able to in order to get what I want. Right? Well, I'm using you simply as a means and not respecting your dignity. Right? What about the person who wants the life of enjoyment? Right? And to let his talents rust? Well, he's not treating himself simply as a means. You could see that there's no direct contradiction of this formulation of the categorical imperative, but really, if you are treating humanity as an end in itself, right, your actions ought harmonize with the fullest possible meaning of humanity, right? So you should develop your talents. If you've got these talents, you should develop them, because then really what you're doing is allowing that humanity to express itself and harmonizing most fully with this formulation of the categorical imperative. Right? What about the miser who's not kicking people while they're down, but he's not helping them either? He's not using them as a means, he's not kicking them while they're down or taking advantage of them, etc., etc. But is he giving them their full dignity and their worth? Is he harmonizing to as great an extent possible by not helping people when he could? No. So we again have an imperfect duty to help others. Now, one last thing that I want to point out to you about Kant, right? And it relates to this kingdom of ends formulation that's so confusing to other people. I mean, there's a simple way to think about this, right? Kant has already argued that these are only so many ways of saying the same thing, right? Now, there's a simple way to think of this, which is just check your math. Now, it's not enough to apply one formulation of the categorical imperative and go, well, I'm done. We have several ways of thinking about this because we need several ways of thinking about this. It seems in some cases that the conclusions of categorical imperative 1 and 2 might differ with one another. The kingdom of ends, it could, as it's expressed on page, I want to say 42. Yeah, he lays out, you know, the general features. Each of these categorical imperatives lay out sort of a specific general, emphasize a specific general feature of the moral law. And he says on 41, the aforementioned three ways of representing the practical, the principle of morality are at bottom so many formulas of the very same law. One of them by itself contains a combination of the other two. Right? Remember, because we can do the things contained in categorical imperative number one, that we are marked off as autonomous beings, and therefore we have the second formulation of the categorical imperative. Basically, what Kant is saying by introducing this kingdom of ends in formulation number three is that, right, each of us as legislators of universal moral law should also be considered legislators in a kingdom of ends rendered possible by freedom of the will, whether as member or as sovereign. Right? So I ought to obey your laws, you ought to obey my laws, and we ought to obey our own laws. Right? Because we are capable of doing this on our own. The feature that Kant is pointing out is, as we apply these formulations of the categorical imperative, we ought to, if we think about it correctly, come to the same conclusions. Your conclusion is different than mine. We've got to revisit rationally the subject. Right? If a conclusion from one contradicts a conclusion from two, we've got to find and craft creatively an action that harmonizes the principle that stands behind each of these in order that the action doesn't contradict. Right? So he tells us, and I started here, page 41. Nevertheless, there is a difference in them which is subjectively rather than objectively practical. That is, it is intended to bring an idea of reason closer to intuition in accordance with a certain analogy, and thereby closer to feeling. All maxims have, namely, a form, which consists in universality, and in this respect, the formula of the moral imperative is expressed thus. Maxims must be so chosen as if they were to hold as universal laws of nature. So, that's heavily emphasized in categorical imperative number one. Two, a matter, that is, an end. And here the formula says that rational beings, inasmuch as by his very nature inasmuch as he is by his very nature an end, and hence an end in himself, must serve in every maxim as a condition limiting all merely relative and arbitrary ends. Emphasized nicely in the second formulation of the categorical imperative, but recall it's because we're autonomous beings that we get this second formulation of the categorical imperative. So, that principle is already present in the first. And then three, a complete determination of all maxims by the formula that all maxims proceeding from his own legislation, right? Remember, formula one and two both have this standing in the background, ought to harmonize with the possible kingdom of ends as a kingdom of nature. Right? So, effectively, what Kant is arguing in terms of the kingdom of ends is that, you know, this isn't just sort of a private sort of math that we do with ourselves. We have to share these laws, and our reason becomes something negotiated publicly, right? And our maxims ought not contradict with one another, right? Mine shouldn't contradict yours. We should not come to the distinct conclusions. So, that's Kantian morality. It's fairly demanding. I hope this video was helpful to you. It's just over 2 hours and may take a long time to put up on YouTube and chew up my bandwidth. But it, like I say, that's only a contingent end kind of thing. It's if I'm treating you as ends in yourself, right? Then I have to afford you the dignity, and this video attempted to do just that. All right. Thank you.